You are listening to An Awakening Podcast. This is an adult conversation about local, worldly, and otherworldly topics. Be prepared, there is some swearing in the podcast.
So anyway, we went out to Brazil. This is the, and I hadn't done anything, and I was coming from my whole, like, I'm sober. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to take a psychedelic again. Like, and it was like, I was afraid, genuinely afraid. And we had to wait around in this city called Recife, which is in the northeast of Brazil. And all the people who were going to do the ayahuasca were there, and we were there for days. And I didn't really understand. I was like, why the fuck were we waiting? And my wife would be like, oh no, they're just waiting for the right time, because we had to drive out and way out to the outskirts into this place where they hold these ceremonies. Mm-hmm. And I'll never forget getting out of the car, coming from the city, this South American city, which was so intense, man. It's like the energy is just so intense. And coming up, and I remember getting out of the car and the fresh air hitting me, like, and it was just like, wow, this is a special place to do this. And I was afraid the whole time. In the preamble, I was afraid. I thought, right, this is probably a mistake that I'm going to do this. But I decided to just go into it anyway. And we all sat around. They lit a fire, and we, you know, I was the only English speaker there, like, apart from my wife, and I couldn't understand a fucking thing that was going on, like, to be honest. I was just going along with the experience. But then I took it, and I took a couple. I think I drank four cups in the end, and everyone else had only drank two, and they were all kind of, like, lying down. They were joking at the time. I remember the guy joking, saying that the dimey's like a sleeping pill tonight, you know, because everybody's just glued to the floor. But I remember sitting with these two guys, and I couldn't really see them. They were sitting in front of me, and I could just see the silhouettes. It was like an hour, and they were wearing their hats, and they were just, I could tell they were watching me, because I was the only one sitting up, and there was this weird kind of communication thing going on with us, you know?
Yeah. Oh,
you know, that kind of, like, it's hard to explain in words, like, what's going on, you know?
Yeah.
But I could just see their silhouettes, and then, like, it was almost like, I just looked up, and the clouds were kind of parting, right? And it was almost like, as I looked up, it was happening at exactly that time. And then I could just see the universe, man.
Yeah.
Above me, the stars came out. And I had this moment of, like, I felt like it was almost like the first time in my life that what I was looking at was, like, recognizing me at the same time.
Exactly. Looking back at you.
Yeah. And I just cried.
Yeah.
I couldn't control it. And they were I could hear them sniggering and stuff, you know, and laughing. Because I'm just there going, whoa, my God. One of those big deep psychedelic experiences, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And then that was that. And I, you know, I went through it and a lot of stuff. And when I actually came back from Brazil that time, I bought myself like a mushroom brick and grew my own mushrooms and everything and grew them on an altar and all. I went real.
Oh,
I got very into it and, like, wanted the right energy. And I was using them then after that quite regularly. Like, I would wait, and then I would, depending on where I was or what I was doing, in the sense, I only ever did them in my living room. And that's when I realized that this is the way you're meant to do these things.
Mm-hmm.
You're not meant to abuse them in the way I was doing it. You know, it's like you realize, like, these things really, really give you a teaching.
Oh, yeah.
And if you're running about drunk and fucking doing all that, I mean, it's a car crash, you know.
Yeah,
And then, so I did all that. I was doing my, as I called them, my ceremonies. And I just, you know, all those things. I did the ayahuasca again for a second time in Brazil, and it was a different experience. We were on a beach, and it was weird. And we actually did it on a Native American burial ground, like one of the old tribal burial grounds as well. It was different. Yeah. Like, it wasn't the same as the first one. And I remember what I got from that one was, it was like this voice in my head that was just saying, because we were watching the ocean, and it was like every wave is a synchronistic event. So every wave that crashes is a synchronicity, but you can't see it. And I'm kind of like, what the fuck does that mean? You know, like this cryptic message, you know.
Yeah.
But it meant like that every wave, kind of what I got from it was like every time a wave crashes on the ocean, it's meant to be there, you know, it's meant to crash. It's like everything is like connected somehow. It was bonkers. Yeah. But that's my experience with psychedelics. When I try and explain them, unless someone has done them, you're just talking about something completely
far. You can't, you know.
Yeah.
It's like saying to somebody about watching a movie they've never seen on TV.
Well, like,
you know what I mean?
You
wouldn't know, have a clue.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what happened then after that? How did you feel after your ayahuasca? What was your experience of your feeling inside yourself? You had a good gurn the first one, you know. But
I actually have, that's actually a pattern. Not a pattern, but like a thing that because what I notice is when I do psychedelics, I do them alone. So I don't do them with other people. I take quite a few.
I don't call them psychedelics.
Entheogens. Whatever it is about them, I do them alone.
Yeah.
And the reason being is unless there's someone that I really trust, and I would do it with them. But for me, is what I've found, and this is just my own way of doing things. Like, if I feel the call to do it, I'll go out and I'll pick a load of mushrooms here, and I'll wait until the right time, and I'll do them, and it'll be a dark room, alone, no distractions, no one else around, and that'll be it. You know, a large dose, and see what happens. And every single time, without fail, I tell you, I end up I will cry. It's usually around the same moment, and it's usually around the moment when the intensity of it is wearing off, and I'm starting to have the comprehension of what I've just gone through, like the hero's journey in 6 hours. You know, you've been beaten around the room, you're seeing all your darkness, and then all of a sudden you come out into this light and you realize and it's mind-blowing. But I, after the ayahuasca, I felt very familiar to it, and I felt it was a very familiar thing, and I've always felt that with...
Did you get that motherly feeling with it?
That was the feeling that I got, that love.
Mother and grandmother thing.
It was like literally there were angels in the sky. I could see them, I just felt them, and they were looking at me smiling with this. It was just like this pure love being poured down on me from the universe. I mean, it was literally, if you imagine... going out to the outskirts in Brazil and the sky, it's just like, Jesus, you've just, like, it's swallowing you up, you know? Yeah. That's why when I walked in, I thought that picture was just incredible.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
I fucking love it, man.
I think they've bought me it, yeah.
Says a lot.
Doesn't it? The picture we're looking at is a picture of a man up a ladder and a wall, and his side of the wall's shit. It's just all wrecked and everything's in shit order. But above the wall is this beautiful galaxy and universe and stars. And
well, that's what I mean. It was that intensity. Mm-hmm. But and that's been my experience with, you know, ayahuasca. And I felt like they are quite similar. I just always, when I took it, I realized, wow, this is a jungle thing. Like, it has the jungle energy in it.
Yeah.
You know, the ayahuasca is that jungle-y, you know, it's like, fuck.
I've been in the jungle so many times, you know, you know, in my journeys.
Of course. And people say the snake and the leopard, it's all jungle animals.
I became
animals,
an anaconda one night in a work. It was a big work, there was a lot of people there. And the chi and energy, whatever you want to call it, when I had built up and that thing was unreal. And I was this anaconda going through the jungle, and I could see the grass and all moving in front of me, you know what I mean? But what was struck me at first was that none of the animals were afraid of me. You know, the wee birds and all weren't getting out of the road. Mm-hmm. And then a cat and all, because they know that I'm not hungry. And I was going along, and what I realized, and it was like getting taught a lesson on an anaconda. It was the anaconda doesn't just go out and eat every fucking thing it sees. It has an area, and it forms it. It knows every animal that's born there. It knows every, you know, so if there's capybaras or whatever, right? And there's not too many, it'll not eat them. It'll let them breed out, and it'll go and eat something else. And it always picks on the weakest first and stuff like that. That's fascinating.
And you got all that through the trip? Through your journey?
Yeah. And that night, a very good friend was there, and I was lit. And I got up, I needed to go to the bog, right? So he went to the bog, and he was coming out, and I just touched him with a finger and blew him in across the room with a chi. And he was near enough paralyzed for a couple of hours. Wow. Just a mad buildup of energy.
Yeah. I find that's the thing about them as well, is that one of the maddest experiences I had, I think this might have been the last time I did them. I did mushrooms, and I'd grown my own. And
what sort did you grow?
Treasure Coast, they were called. They were very like DMT, I have to say. They were very visual, super visual, and super strong, do you know? And I was in Italy, And we tried to move to Italy. And
I love Italy.
Special place. Like,
isn't it gorgeous?
And, well, it did, anyway, for one reason and another, it didn't work out. But I had the last of my mushrooms. I think it was about 7 dry grams or something. And I was like, well, you know what I'm going to do?
Do you like them?
Yeah, all of them, right?
Yeah.
And it was, like, it was just, what I remember most is when it came on, the effects. You know the way you're normally sitting there and you kind of go, is this working? Is it not?
Yeah,
there's that wee period of in between where
and
you're uneasy and there's anxious. That didn't happen. It was just like I was sitting there and I was going, I wonder when this is going to kick in. Next thing, the room just went like in a big spiral that I couldn't control and I shit myself.
Oh, wow.
I remember going, oh, but I lost complete control. So it wasn't like there was no resistance because I couldn't. Yes. Do you see what I mean? There was no Terry there to kind of go, I don't want it, this is too strong. It was like full immersion, you know.
Did you ever try the big red jobs on a meat of muscaria?
I never got the chance because...
I did, yeah.
And what did you think of them? I saw them over there.
It's a painting he's talking about in case you think about the mushrooms going in the fucking living room. It was a very long... 12-hour thing. It was very tough, a lot of shitting, a lot of booking, but it was one of the most amazing experiences of my life.
Really?
You were talking about the father thing. Part of my journey with that night was, at one stage, when I get the booking and shitting over, all these faces started flashing in front of me. And it was all people who had harmed me or done something against me in my life. And as it came up, I forgive them. Forgive them. There's people I didn't even know who forgive were. I had no idea, but I forgive them anyway. And the next thing, my dad. I looked at him. I said, I love you, dad. Boom. A different place. It was unbelievable. It was fantastic. Wonderful experience. I had my granny appear and hug me and stand in front of me saying, don't you ever give up. Keep going. That was very...
That's incredible.
Yeah.
I knew a guy who did them. He used to pick the Liberty Caps and the Amanitas, and he would make some kind of potion.
Of the two of them?
Two of them together. He would do it in a way...
Holy Jesus.
He was a bit of a hermit. I mean, he was he practiced hermeticism. He's the guy I was telling you about who did the earthing. He just used to go into the woods for days on his own, and he'd be foraging, and he would be in his bare feet the whole time. And, I mean, he was an incredible guy. His knowledge about, like... astrology and stuff.
Yeah.
He was the one actually who took me from an idea. He was such a cool dude, right? He was a mad bastard from London. And you know, his upbringing was just so brutal. You know, grew up in the fish markets in London, running the streets, like hardcore guy, and he had gone through so much, and then he had transformed himself. And but he was a very recluse kind of guy, lived in the woods, and you know, he was all about the following the moon cycles and stuff, like he was totally attuned.
Yeah.
So plant, I loved
planting the moon.
Even more so about, he would look at the things that are going on in the world, and he would be looking at the astrology, and he would be mapping out the collective, like he'd be going, you know, and he actually got me to a point where I started to tune in and started to feel it myself, because he would be like, well as you're building up to a full moon, start to feel it. And be like, set your intent on the moon and feel the energy. And then he would be like, observe others on the full moon. And right enough, I started to do it myself, and I'd be like, okay, the build up, I got the apple, I was watching. And it is incredible, the moon build up, the full moon, the build up to a full moon. I think the problem is people don't pay attention, but you see, when you actually put your intent on it and say, I'm going to pay attention, you see it in people.
Yeah, but we're all in cities with big lights. No?
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
We don't have any idea.
You're
but
sitting
anyway,
in a forest or sitting in a
exactly. It doesn't mean anything, but it's affecting you in some way. So he ended up he would do these things. He said he would be tripping for 3 days.
Holy shit.
3 days. And he would just go into whatever, you know, he says the fairy realm. And, you know, that's what he called it, the fairy realm, for 3 days. And then he would just come out again and just be like, nuts. But it's just madness, you know. And I loved, do you know what I loved? Is when I would meet someone like that. Now I never see him again. I haven't seen him, haven't heard from him. But his short period in my life of maybe like, I think it was a year and a half, 2 years, the information that he gave me.
Yeah.
And the opened my eyes to so much.
Fantastic.
You know, and it's what we were talking about, the domes and how we build these structures. And he would open my eyes to this idea that there's a lot more to this reality than what were being told, oh, you know, and that was such a gift for me, you know. Mm-hmm.